Ladies and gentlemen, we present The Best of Dickie Bird.
They always blame me for bad light, don't they? It's always that Dickie Bird. They don't realise there's another umpire with me. It's always me. I always remember in a test match at Old Trafford, England were playing Australia. And Australia were batting and England were fielding. And we all came off the field, all the players and the two umpires, and we were walking up the members' enclosure to the dressing rooms at Old Trafford. There was a Lancashire member at the top of the members' enclosure. He'd had so much to drink he couldn't stand. He said, "You're here again, Bird, you're here again." So every time you come to Old Trafford, you're always bringing them off. "Surely it's not bad light, sun shining." I said, "No, sir, it's lunchtime."
Keith Miller was one of the great Australian characters before and after the war. Keith lived in Sydney and captained New South Wales. He was a bit forgetful at times, and one day the umpire called him over and said, "Excuse me, Mr. Miller, but I think you'll find that you've got 12 men on the field." Miller turned to his men, pointed at one of them at random and barked, "You, bugger off, the rest scatter." On another occasion, the team was all set to take the field when Keith was asked, "Where's old so-and-so?" "No idea," said Keith. "Is he supposed to be playing?" "Yes," came the reply. "And you were supposed to be giving him a lift." Oh, dear.
There is a lot of massive appealing now which has crept into the game, where they're running down the wicket at you, charging you, you know. They run at you, everybody. I mean, when they charged at me down the wicket and everybody coming, third man and fine leg running at you and all, you know, I used to just say, "Not out." "Not out. Not out. Get on with the game. Not out." That quietens them down. Charging, running at me. I think my most embarrassing test match, that was when nature called and I came off the field at Old Trafford in a test match. I stopped the test match and Botham were bawling from my end. I said, "I've got to go off, Bot. I've got to go to the toilet." "As you can't, middle of a test match." He said, "There's still an hour left to go before lunch." I said, "I've got to go." He said, "Well, if you've got to go, you've got to go." So I said, "I'm sorry, gentlemen, but nature calls." And I just ran off the field. Went into the toilet, came back down the members' enclosure, Old Trafford, full house at Old Trafford. I pulling my zip up and the crowd erupted. I think that was my most embarrassing.
There can hardly have been a more endearing character at Essex than Brian Tonker Taylor. They called him that because he loved to give the ball an almighty tonk. He was both captain and wicketkeeper, and under him Essex were never short of ideas of getting batsmen out. Like one time when Tonker set out to trick a compulsive hooker into playing the shot that would most likely prove his undoing. Sure enough, the batsman, unable to resist the temptation, hooked the ball high and hard and was brilliantly caught just inside the ropes. Tonker and his team were ecstatic, until they realised that the umpire had called no ball. All eyes turned accusingly towards the bowler and his frustrated colleagues tore him off a right strip, until the umpire explained that he had not called the bowler for overstepping. He turned to Tonker. "It was your fault, skipper," he said to him. "You've three men behind square. The law allows for only two." Tonker looked round in disbelief. He counted once, he counted twice, and he counted again. Then the penny dropped. "Don't tell me you were counting that chap right on the boundary edge," he muttered menacingly. "Of course," replied the umpire. "That's not a fielder, you fool," explored at Tonker. "That's the bloody ice cream man." One match at Chelmsford in 1996 will always stick in my mind. Essex were playing India, and during the match some building work was going on at the hospital just outside the ground. A massive mechanical hammer made a terrible noise throughout play. Boom, 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 boom it went, non-stop. It was driving me crackers. You would think I could have coped, having umpired in India, where the noise from the crowd is unbelievable, but this was something else. It went right through you all day long. Finally, I could stand it no longer, and I sent a message to the workmen asking if it would be possible for them not to make any noise during the hours of play. They could use the hammer from hell, I suggested, during our lunch and tea intervals and in the evening after play at stop for the day. Either that or put a muffler on the damn thing. I hardly dare tell you the message I received back, but it began with an F and ended in an off. There have always been characters at Nottinghamshire, and one of the first I came across was Charlie Harris, among the funniest men ever to play cricket. My sides ached with laughing the first time I heard the tale of when he ended up in hospital after dislocating his shoulder while fielding. He was moaning and groaning as they tried to put the shoulder back in place, and finally the nurse could stand it no longer. "Mr. Harris," she scolded, "I'm surprised at you. You're making a dreadful fuss about having your shoulder put back. There's a woman downstairs who has just had twins and she's making far less fuss than you." To which Charlie replied, "That's as may be, but you try and put in them back and see what she says." Jack Simmons was renowned as being a typical born and bred Lancashire man, with a love of meat pies and mushy peas. He knew all the best meat shops in the county. In fact, it is said that if ever Jack goes sightseeing, it is round the butcher's shops. On one occasion, he took a lunch order for fish and chips between overs, for players who felt like a change of menu.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.